Gold, Juno and Sword were the code names of the ones where the British and Canadian troops came ashore, and Utah and Omaha were where the Americans landed. It's hard to imagine now, even on a day like this, but this was part of Juno Beach. Here at Courcelles-sur-Mer, the Canadians fought across these sands before pushing inland.
Long ago, Courcelles went back to being a modest little seaside resort, famous for its oysters. And long ago, too, the cliffs at Point du Hoc reverted to a reassuring landmark for local fishermen. Yet here was some of the bloodiest fighting of the D-Day dawn, as US Rangers scaled the rock face to take the position on the cliff top.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are now standing on top of a 100-foot high cliff.
Major Tony Holt and his wife have been guiding groups around European battlefields for 7 years. They have some 14 different tours, ranging from Napoleon to Normandy, Waterloo to Pointe du Hoc.
And in between the two beaches, a large gap. And in the center of the gap, almost, is the cliff upon which you stand. And on top of that cliff, half a dozen 6-inch guns that could shoot onto each of those landing beaches. And the Allies could not afford to have those destroyers up there shooting onto the Americans as they landed.
Holidays and history here are inextricable. Aramanche is one of a string of villages along this coast that owe their livelihoods to their firm sands and small hotels, and their lives to the events of 40 years ago. The remains of the Mulberry Harbour, an artificial port the size of Dover, ring the bay like a jaw of broken teeth. One massive section still litters the beach. No one seeing this could misunderstand the scale of the D-Day landings. Inside a museum which overlooks the ruins in the sea, models, photographs and film show how the Mulberry was made. Giant concrete caissons weighing between 3,000 and 6,000 tons formed the outer breakwater protecting the pierheads. These were designed to rise and fall with the tide, sliding up and down on piles driven into the seabed. Floating piers ran to the shore, spindly jetties that enabled an army to walk on water. Bayeux, 5 miles from the coast, was the first town in France to be liberated. Now it's perfectly placed as a base from which to tour this part of Normandy. Miraculously, unlike so many other towns and villages, Bayeux came through the war unscathed. The 900-year-old spires of the Cathedral of Notre Dame soar above the town unblunted. The cathedral was built by William the Conqueror's half-brother, the Bishop of Bayeux.
This is the chart on which Eisenhower and Montgomery watched the progress of the invasion. It was part of an enormous wooden map of the whole of Europe. Only after it had been brought here, this one critically secret section was cut out, the only bit they wanted.